Hola, muy buenos días. Bienvenidos y bienvenidas a todas las personas que se están conectando a esta sesión con KTH Royal Institute of Technology. Mi nombre es Carolina Leguizamón. Yo hago parte del equipo de Consejería Académica y Relaciones Internacionales de Colfuturo. Y hoy nos acompaña Magnus Lindqvist en representación de la universidad y también Mayela González, quien nos va a estar compartiendo un poco de su experiencia y también va a estar participando en la sesión de preguntas y respuestas al final. Bueno, para iniciar me gustaría contarles o resaltar que hasta la convocatoria de este año 2021 han sido seleccionadas 46 personas beneficiarias del programa Crédito Beca para ir a realizar sus estudios a KTH. Más específicamente en el 2021 fueron seleccionadas 4 personas, así que es una opción muy recurrente entre nuestros beneficiarios y es por eso que los hemos invitado a este espacio para que nos puedan brindar información acerca de su oferta académica, proceso de admisión, becas y en general resolver todas las dudas que puedan tener. Para esto pueden dejar sus preguntas en el chat y al final vamos a tener un espacio para responder estas preguntas. También me gustaría compartir con ustedes que con KTH tenemos un convenio que otorga un 20% de descuento en el valor de la matrícula para 10 beneficiarios del programa Crédito Beca de Colfuturo. Este convenio solamente es válido para personas que cursen la totalidad de su programa en KTH. Entonces, bueno, sin más preámbulo, thank you so much, Magnus, for accepting the invitation, for joining us in this session.
Thank you very much, Carolina. It's a pleasure to be here, as always. And hello, everyone. And thank you for joining this event and for having the interest to listen to us from KTH and for your interest to potentially study with us as well. My name is Magnus Lindqvist, and I work in the International Relations Office at KTH. We have worked for several years with different universities and organizations in Colombia, and we have been very happy to receive students, very good and competent students from Colombia to our university. So that's why it's a pleasure to be here today and to present our university a little bit more in detail to you here and now. I also, with me is one of our current students, Mayela González. Hello, Mayela. She's a student from Mexico, and I will hand over the word after my presentation to her so she can tell you a little bit more how it is to be a student at KTH and some of the considerations that could be good to think about before arriving to KTH. So yeah, without further ado, I will try to share my presentation here. Sorry, let's start from the beginning here. Okay, so I hope that all of you can see my slides. And Carolina, please let me know if there is any problem.
We can see it.
Thank you so much. So yeah, we are the KTH Royal Institute of Technology. And this slide, what you see here is actually the graduation ceremony that we have at the Royal Institute of Technology. There are all the master students. We also have the equal celebration for PhD students when they graduate. This is in the City Hall in Stockholm. And some of you might recognize this hall because that's also where we have the Nobel Prize ceremony, where we hand out the prize to the Nobel laureates who win the Nobel Prize. But at least you will have the chance to be in this beautiful building when you have finished your studies at KTH. And I would like also to say a little bit about our main vision and objectives at KTH when we promote our universities to you. A little bit what a summary what we would like to offer to you. We have three pillars, you could say. So we would like, the most important thing is to offer you a master degree of the highest international standard within your subject in engineering and technology. And then we also have a very strong focus on innovation. So innovative thinking and an entrepreneurial mindset is also something that we work very strongly with at KTH. And then, of course, we would also be happy, and we hope we can offer also up to 2 years of your studies in one of the world's safest and most livable cities. And I will talk a little bit more about this in my presentation. But first, I would like to show you a video from the Swedish Institute. This is a little video that we have. Okay, so as you could see in the video there, there were both some cultural and geographical and also industrial aspects of Sweden. And I would like to start also to talk about Sweden as a country and as a society. We are quite an open and multicultural society. We have people coming and working from all around the world. And also as students at KTH, you will be a group together with many students from around the world and a very cultural student population that we have, actually one of the most diverse student populations in Sweden, in the universities in Sweden. As you can see here on this slide, Sweden, we're quite a big country if you compare it to other countries in Europe, but we are not so densely populated. So we are 10 million inhabitants in our country. And I think we are like the fourth biggest country in Europe. So there is a lot of space. If you like nature and wilderness, I don't think you will be disappointed in Sweden. Maybe some of you have heard about the Nordic or the Aurora lights in the north of Sweden. And of course, also we have quite long winters. But the winters you can use going skiing or just being out in beautiful white landscape and clean air. And then we also focus a lot on gender equality in Sweden. As you saw in the movie or in the clip, there were some companies. You saw Skype and Hennes & Mauritz, and maybe some of the furnitures from IKEA. These are all Swedish multinational companies. We work at KTH, we work closely with a lot of them, like Volvo, Saab, Electrolux. I know that when I've been in Colombia, I see that in many houses there are appliances from Electrolux, and then also for electrical engineering, it's ABB, it's one of the biggest engineering companies in the world. And except being strong in industrial production, we also do a lot of innovation. So at the current time, we are usually normally top five in the world of the countries on the innovation index. Right now, we're on number three. And this is something that we, as I said in the beginning, we like to also promote during your studies at KTH, to see how can innovation already during your studies be part of your future career. And in this aspect, I should also mention that we work a lot with a triple helix model, where we try to do projects together with the public sector, that is the government, and the industry sector. And a lot of the things that we do in the Swedish society when it comes to smart cities or artificial intelligence or industrial production, it's to see how we can coordinate projects between different sectors of the society. Some few innovations that you might have heard of is, of course, I think all of you know Spotify and Bluetooth, but also historically Sweden was the inventor of the modern seatbelt, pacemaker, the zipper, and some of you might like Candy Crush Saga and Minecraft. So KTH, we are a university located in the city capital, and that is Stockholm. And in Stockholm, we are trying to work a lot with safety and, as I said, multicultural ethnicity, multicultural aspects in the city as well. So at the present time, we're ranked the 12th safest city in the world. And we are also on equal position when it comes to the most livable city in the world. We have guaranteed housing for students like coming from Colombia. We help you or find accommodation. It could be quite difficult at times in Stockholm as a student to find accommodation, but this is something as a university that we will help you with. And then I also done a small budget where you can see a little bit what you could expect as a student, the cost of living for 1 month. And that will include everything from housing, food, insurance, also some travels and internet and phone costs, which should be around $880 to $1,000 per month. And then to dive into KTH at last. Here you see the main campus building in our city campus. This is our main campus in the city center of Stockholm. Our university was established in 1827 by, it's founded, so it's almost soon to be 200 years old. And we're very proud of that. And the guardian of our university is the Swedish king, King Carl the 16th, Gustav. Our king is not practically involved in everyday matters, of course, but he is still like an ambassador of our university. And at the current time, we have around 13,000 students, 2,000 PhD students, and around 310 full-time professors in our university. And to the left, to the right, you can see our main library. So these are actually also a kind of innovation that we have done, where we have a courtyard between houses, and we decided to build a roof so we could achieve more space by having it like a room of our library. As you can see, we're quite close. Here is a picture of Stockholm, a big part actually of the city center of Stockholm. And as you can see, our campus is just located in connection to the city center. And it's quite a big campus. So we have both railway, I mean, not personally for the university, but we're close to a railway station where you can have metro and the regional trains as well. Some of the local regional trains. We have sports centers on the on our campus library. And then we are surrounded to one side of this Royal National Park, where we have a lot of forest and a lot of tracks to go running or walking or just hanging out, having picnics. And on the other side, you have a quick access to the city center of Stockholm. Some of the of the text you see here is names of other campuses. You have Kista, KTH, Solna in the top of this slide. That's actually satellite campuses where we have other fields of our university. For example, in KTH Kista, we have our ICT in telecommunication and computer science. And in Solna, we have life sciences. And then KTH Flemingsberg and KTH Södertälje, that's actually more related to industrial production. So some of you might be going to some of these campuses to do courses and be part of the faculties, the departments there, but all of you will have some and several of your classes in the main campus as well. Yeah, so we had quite important visits sometimes at KTH. We had in 2013, we actually were asked by President Barack Obama when he visited Sweden if he could visit KTH. So we were, of course, thrilled to receive Obama to our university. And we could show him some of our fields of studies and research. And then we also had a couple of years ago, the late Stephen Hawking. We did a seminar, a conference at KTH, and Stephen Hawking visited us. So it was amazing to see him there as well. When you arrive to prepare your studies or to start your studies, we have this pickup services at the airport, and we also have a student service reception building where you can get help for counseling, finding your way around the campus, opening up your internet or your computer accounts inside the campus. So this is something that is good to know. And then, as you probably have seen a little bit, since you seem to have an interest in KTH, we offer quite a lot of subjects within engineering and technology and natural sciences. And I will go very briefly. I will try to go through the main topics. Sorry, first I will start with the structure of our studies. So we have, as you can see here, the structure of studies in Sweden is that you start with a bachelor's degree for 3 years. Then you do a master's degree for 2 years, which is also the topic of today's presentation. And then we have a doctoral degree for 4 years that I guess that might some of you might continue through the doctoral degree as well. The master's degree is based on 2 years, and we have the first 3 years, the first 1.5 year, that's theoretical or class-based courses. And then the last semester in the program, there is a degree project. So it's actually fully devoted 20 weeks of a thesis project where you can, together with your supervisor at KTH or together with industry, you can develop a thesis project that you can present. And then just to give you a very, very short summary of the fields or the departments we have. Here you have, you can see all of these black dots are programs, master programs. So in the department or the School of Architecture and Built Environment, we offer all these master programs. So everything from architecture to real estate management, also transportation and urban planning. And in the Electrical Engineering and Computer Science School, we have a lot of program in telecommunications, in distributed system, artificial intelligence, robotics, and also information technology connected to innovation, a lot of courses and packed in with innovation to this. Machine learning is also things that we are very strong in this. And of course, energy programs in power engineering, where there is a lot of focus on renewable energy, for example. And then engineering sciences, we have also classical programs in mechanical engineering, And then we also have specific programs in nuclear energy or railway energy engineering, and also some of the computer simulations programs. In life sciences and biology, we have everything from sports technology to medical biotechnology or molecular or macromolecular materials that we do a lot. We're also quite strong in polymer materials. Industrial engineering is also programs that are very connected to innovation and industrial engineering, industrial management. And also how, and I think Mayela will can mention this a little bit more since she is a student at KTH, but usually we focus a lot on lectures and seminars. So we try to do, it has been difficult in the pandemic, but we try to do teamwork and to do rather smaller seminars than big auditorium or classroom lectures. We like when the students can interact and when you can be part of a team solving practical problems. Of course, there is a lot of theory, but at least sometimes we try to implement in the courses that you have specific tasks to solve in a team. And the admission requirements is also good to know. Usually, or always, the students that apply to the master degree, there should be a bachelor degree. You don't have to, when you apply, you don't have to have a finished bachelor degree, but you should have be in the last semester of your bachelor degree, and you can apply. The deadline is in the middle of January, the 15th of January. And then the requirements we have is the English proficiency. So TOEFL or IELTS are usually the English proficiency test that we use. And you can also read more here about the requirements. Yeah, we also have the tuition fees that we have had to implement being part of the European Union. So as you see, for the full program, the cost is approximately $34,000 for the full program. We have a KTH scholarship that we offer to some of the students. We don't have a lot of scholarships, but we try to offer as many as we can. And all the students that apply to KTH can sign up to be part of the scholarship process. And then how to apply. So you need to choose, of course, the program of interest and then submit your application to the 15th of January. And here I recommend also that you look to the KTH and SI scholarships. There are information on our webpage about these scholarships. And then that you can complement the last documents of your application, the 1st of February. And there is also application fee around $100 when you apply to KTH. And then you will get your results in April. I will very quickly go through. We have, of course, a lot of our students, most of them, they have found a job within 1 year of their studies, of the graduation. They will have found a job in the industry or continuing within the university. And here you can see some of the biggest company where we have had a lot of alumni, so they have we have a very close cooperation with these industries where they are also big employers for KTH alumni when they finish their studies. And we are also very interested in having PhD students. If you like being part of the academic sector, there are quite a lot of positions for PhD. We have around 2,000 PhD students at the university, so if you are interested, this is something that you can definitely see as a potential future career as well. So as I said, there is also a strong focus and we have a lot of students going to the PhD. Finally, I just want to end this presentation by giving you some further information or links where you can find information. We have, of course, a Facebook account, we have Instagram or Twitter, and a LinkedIn account as well. Then on our webpage, we have like Maiela is a good example, we have digital ambassadors that are doing blogs, or they are helping us to provide information to potential students as well. So you feel very free to contact us. I can see that there is an email missing here. The email is info@kth.se, where you can address any questions you have regarding your studies at KTH. So we are looking very much forward to welcoming you and to answer any of your questions that you might have. Yeah, so I stop there, and I thank you very much for listening to the presentation. I see the time went away very fast, but I will hand over to Maiela. So please, Maiela, I'm very happy that you took the time to join us today. So I hand it over to you.
Yes, thank you, Magnus, for having me. Voy a hacer la presentación en español porque siento que es más cómodo para todos aquí, que supongo hablan español. Bueno, primero que nada, como Magnus mencionó, están todos los social media de la escuela. A lo mejor algunos me han visto si siguen la cuenta de Instagram. Yo, junto con otro compañero, manejamos esa cuenta. Entonces, igual cualquier duda que lleguen a tener, nos pueden buscar por ahí. Con mucho gusto les echamos la mano. Y pues yo voy a hacer una presentación muy cortita acerca de mi experiencia acá. Bueno, primero que nada, ¿por qué escogí el KTH? Yo entiendo que moverse a otro país pues es una gran decisión, y dije, bueno, si lo voy a hacer, lo voy a hacer como los grandes y voy a escoger la escuela que esté mejor rankeada. La verdad es que me basé en el ranking, y pues el KTH es una de las más prestigiosas aquí en Suecia, entonces dije, bueno, va. La verdad es que no tuve que contactar a la escuela para nada en cuestión de qué ven en el programa en el que apliqué y tal, porque la verdad la página viene súper completa, la actualizan muy, muy seguido. Entonces ahí pude ver todos los cursos que iba a tener que tomar, todo el enfoque que tenía mi programa. Yo estudio Environmental Engineering and Sustainable Infrastructure. Escogí este precisamente porque se ajustaba mucho al background que ya tengo, que es ingeniería ambiental. Entonces traté de aplicar al que sintiera yo que tenía más chances de entrar. Entonces esa fue la decisión por la que apliqué. El proceso fue bastante sencillo, únicamente es juntar todos los papeles. Yo creo que el examen de inglés fue el que pues más tardó, porque te tardan un poco en darte los resultados. Pero en aproximadamente un mes tenía yo todo, lo mandas y muy puntual te avisan si entraste o no entraste. Y algo que me gusta mucho del KTH fue que en cuanto tuve la noticia de que había sido admitida, te contactan muy personalmente, te mandan toda la información que necesitas, porque en ese momento es muy abrumador el ya es real, me voy a ir, pues cómo, cuándo, qué más tengo que hacer. Entonces la verdad es que el KTH es muy bueno para, pues, así que agarrarte la mano y llevarte durante el proceso. Tienen un evento que se llama Call Up Week, que un estudiante de acá te contacta personalmente y tienes una, puede ser videollamada, llamada por teléfono, para que te cuenten su experiencia, cómo es vivir acá, te resuelven las dudas, un poquito para que no te sientas tan solo en el proceso. Yo estuve también en estas llamadas y hablé con varias personas de Colombia que iban a venir acá, que habían sido admitidas. Entonces ese tipo de dinámicas creo que la escuela es muy buena, y bueno, todos los sistemas de apoyo a través del correo, y cuando llegas acá igual está toda la gente que te recibe en los arrival dates. La verdad es que todo es bastante organizado en ese sentido. También una ventaja que tenemos por ser no europeos es que nos garantizan el housing con tal de que apliques a tiempo. Entonces eso también es bueno, porque sí cuesta un poco de trabajo encontrar housing los primeros meses. Ya después que estás acá ya vas tanteando y consigues sin problema, pero pues estando desde tan lejos es mucho más cómodo saber que mínimo ya llegas a algo seguro. Y yo me mudé a Suecia en el peor año que pude haber escogido, porque fue a la mitad de la pandemia. Aún así todo salió bien, el permiso de residencia, todo. Hay que aplicar con tiempo, es mucha paciencia, pero al final se logró. Yo no he tenido la ventaja de tener clases presenciales todavía. El campus estuvo abierto todo el tiempo, digo, con sus restricciones, y era de cada quien decidir si iba o no. Yo fui en algunas ocasiones con mi, no sé si tenía algún group project, iba con el equipo y ahí nos veíamos para trabajar, pero en sí las clases han sido en línea. Sé que ahora ya hay muchas más clases presenciales, ahora yo también estoy yendo más al campus. Entonces Pues sí, digamos que la vida estudiantil no ha sido una mala experiencia, pero a lo mejor no fue al 100% como hubiera sido en otro año, pero pues este año fue excepcional, no solamente aquí, sino en todo el mundo. Entonces todas las escuelas estaban en línea y realmente Suecia fue un país que a lo mejor polémicamente abarcó el tema de la pandemia con un approach un poco diferente. Entonces la verdad es que yo me sentí con toda la libertad de vivir casi en la normalidad, casi nada estaba cerrado, se puede salir. También yo creo que influye mucho que, pues sí, la población no es tan alta, entonces el distanciamiento social se da naturalmente, también culturalmente la gente acá tiende a ser, no me gusta decir que son fríos, pero son sumamente respetuosos del espacio personal. Entonces realmente había mucho social distancing naturalmente. Y la experiencia acá es increíble, no le tengan miedo al invierno. A mí me espantaron mucho que el invierno era horrible, y digo, sí, pues sí es oscuro, pero pues es una nueva experiencia. Yo nunca había visto la nieve, me tocó que nevara padrísimo. He hecho muchos amigos internacionales. Estocolmo es una ciudad muy internacional. Y yo vivo en un student room, entonces comparto la cocina con pues personas de todo el mundo, entonces jamás hubiera pensado que un día iba a cenar con gente de todas partes del mundo y poder platicar, intercambiar experiencias y tal. Entonces algo que el KTH me ha ofrecido, porque tienen mucho alumno internacional. Y pues sí, mi experiencia como estudiante ha sido esa. Confirmo lo del el empleo, la verdad me costó mucho trabajo conseguir, yo ya conseguí un part-time job, también estoy trabajando con la escuela. Para la gente que se quiera quedar a largo plazo, el idioma, la verdad, a mí me parece que sí es importante. La escuela también ofrece cursos del idioma, pero en realidad, si únicamente quieren venir a hacer el máster con el inglés, es más que suficiente. Todo Suecia habla perfecto inglés, se pueden mover sin ningún problema, entonces tampoco se sientan con miedo del idioma, porque se puede vivir perfectamente solo con inglés, y ya a lo mejor ya para un trabajo, pues sí, echarle un poquito más de ganas al idioma. Y pues la verdad yo lo recomiendo al 100%, está increíble que tengan esta oportunidad con a lo mejor alguna beca, porque pues entiendo que los fees son pues no precisamente muy baratos, pero si tienen la oportunidad de venir, la verdad es que yo lo recomendaría con los ojos cerrados. Es una calidad de vida completamente diferente. Sé que también luego preocupa un poco que sí es muy caro, digo, a comparación de los países de los que venimos de Latinoamérica, pues sí, sí se eleva el costo, pero también puede ser tan caro como uno quiera, y pues digo, mientras uno no se ponga a comer caviar, pues todo se puede medio balancear, y la calidad de vida yo creo que lo vale mucho, sobre todo, por ejemplo, como mujer latina, el sentirme segura cuando salgo en la noche para mí no tiene precio. La igualdad de género también es una cosa que todos los días me impresiona cada vez más, y me he sentido muy bienvenida desde que llegué. Jamás me he sentido así que, ay, soy la que viene de fuera y I don't fit in, cosas por el estilo. La verdad me he sentido muy bienvenida y la escuela ha sido un gran factor para eso. Entonces eso sería todo de mi parte, no sé si yo proceda.
Okay, so now we can move with the Q&A session. We have received a couple of questions in the chat. The first one is for Magnus. Jenny is asking, should the IELTS be 6.5 in average or each band?
It's in average.
All right, thank you. And this is for Mayela. Jenny pregunta, ¿cómo homologaste o qué te solicitaron para certificar tu pregrado de ingeniería ambiental para presentarte al máster de sostenibilidad e infraestructura?
Bueno, yo me gradué en 2018, entonces en México el proceso es te gradúas y te dan una cosa que se llama título, seguramente debe ser algo muy parecido en Colombia, y te dan, pues es un certificado, es una cosa como de este tamaño. Lo único que hice fue escanearla, traducirla, y esa fue la que mandé junto con todas mis calificaciones.
Gracias. Jesús pregunta si es posible que dejes tu correo electrónico o un medio de contacto.
Sí, ahorita se los escribo, y también pueden seguirnos en la página de Instagram, porque creo que ese es un poco más, bueno, yo la siento un poco más directa, y ahí tengo a alguien que igual me echa la mano para contestarles, pero igual si quieren por correo también se los puedo dejar.
Gracias. This one is for Magnus. Santiago is asking, is it possible to apply to start in summer 2022?
Yeah, we have the semesters that we have. The first semester is in the academic year is this semester. So it starts in September and it goes until the end of December, even into January a bit. And then the second semester is from January, February until June. So to start, the best time to apply, or the only time to apply as an international student, is between November to January. So the deadline is January the 15th, and then you will start the program in the beginning of September. So you will probably arrive during August, in the middle of August, or in the end of August, to be part of the introduction, and then starting the classes, the real classes in September.
Okay, thank you. And Jose is asking, are there scholarships available directly with KTH?
Yes, so we have our own scholarships that we distribute. We try to offer as many as we can. I think we have around 50 to 70 scholarships. And then we have around 600 international students. So that's more or less the percentage that you can calculate also that. Of course, it's not so easy to get the scholarship, but it's definitely worth to apply for the KTH scholarship. And on our webpage, if you go into the information about our master programs, the English webpage, you will also find the link to the scholarship information. And there is also information because we have KTH scholarships, and then we have through the Swedish government, they have an agency called the Swedish Institute that were producing the clip I showed you also in the presentation. They also offer scholarships to students from Colombia. And then, of course, maybe the most important partner for us is Colfuturo, because you also then have the opportunity to provide scholarships. So all of these options are available, and each year we have students from Latin America and from Colombia also that receive scholarships from KTH.
Okay, thank you. Ruth is asking, are there any programs available, PhD programs in communication or education?
Yes, it's a very interesting question, because I always say frequently engineering and technology, but actually at KTH we work a lot with pedagogy as well, and learning for higher education. Also processes of quality assurance for universities and university organization is important for us to improve our education and research. So we actually have a department who is working with teaching, communication, perhaps not pure communication as communication sciences, but we have also part of, like, for the areas of the telecommunications, there we have also, of course, courses in communications, for example. But I will say for the PhD, I actually personally have a friend of mine and a colleague who is doing his PhD in the Department of Learning. He's doing it more to see how to organize and how to develop universities. But they also have a lot of, for example, how the teaching, problem-based learning. There is it's a concept called CDIO, which is also related to how you can teach. Teaching in STEM is also a big subject there.
And if I can add something to that really quickly.
Sure, please.
Porque justo hoy tuvimos una plática y creo que hay una diferencia entre los PhDs acá y en Latinoamérica, o por lo menos en México, que nosotros estamos acostumbrados a que un PhD es como aplicar para un tercer grado de educación, y acá realmente el PhD se maneja como un trabajo, es un empleo. Entonces, los que quieran aplicar para un PhD, aplicas mandando CV, con varios requerimientos, pero no es que porque aplicas quedas o porque haya como una opción, como si fuera un otro máster, sino aquí lo consideran como un trabajo y se hace una entrevista y te contratan para que estudies un PhD. Entonces, para que tengan en cuenta que es un poquito diferente a como nosotros estamos acostumbrados, como si fuera un programa más y aplicas y quedas, sino acá lo manejan como si fuera un empleo.
That's a very good and important point. And I would just like to say that you can also, for those of you who are here today maybe and are interested in a PhD, there is also information on the webpage how to apply, because we, as Mayela was saying, we announce the positions as work positions. So you apply with your studies and the research maybe that you have done. But then you also get like a fixed position during those years and a salary as well.
All right. Thank you so much, both of you. The next question is from Sergio. He's asking how important or decisive are the grades from the university, the GPA, in order to apply, because he says that he has a low score. So his question is if it's possible to get an opportunity in the university.
Yeah, I mean, okay, so sure. Requisite is, of course, the grades and the GPA in a way, but it's not the only thing. So at KTH, as I said, in the three pillars, we work a lot with innovation and also sustainability. It should be there as well as part of the pillars, because now we're focusing very hard on strongly on sustainability. So when you apply to KTH, you can write, or you should write, a personal letter as part of the application. And to many of the programs, they play a big part in the admission. If you write why you want to study at KTH, connected to innovation and sustainability, it's a very strong argument. So I can really, like, it's a little bit off the table hint is, or a recommendation is that you try to write a personal letter where you specify not only why you are interested in your subject of engineering, you should do that too, but also what you would like to do after you finish your education. Like maybe some of you would like to work with processes in sustainability or innovation. You could imagine building your own company or do research, for example. So things like that is very, it gives an extra dimension to the application that is important as well. I don't know, Mayela, if you have any experiences when you applied, how this part with your personal letter was.
A mí también me dieron el tip de tratar de poner lo más que pudiera, ser muy específica en la, yeah, like motive letter, la carta que escribes, y que fuera muy hacia lo sustentable y porque quería precisamente el programa que escogí, ta, ta, ta. Y de calificaciones, digo, yo apliqué para la beca de KTH y pues no me la dieron. Pero de calificaciones yo salí con un promedio de 8.9 de 10. Tenía calificaciones de 6.1, 7, algunas muy altas, unas no tanto, y al final pues sí entré. Creo que depende mucho, como dice Magnus, de las otras cosas que hay que enviar, de tus razones personales, de por las cuales escogiste el KTH, y pues también la competencia. Varía mucho de año con año. Si a lo mejor tu competencia no tiene calificaciones igual tan altas, pues eso se empareja. A lo mejor si es un año que compites con gente, pues sí que tiene super calificaciones, igual y se afecta más. Entonces creo que varía mucho, pero yo creo que no se pierde nada con intentarlo. Digo, a menos que sea super reprobado, pues igual y no es la mejor opción, pero mientras estén normales las calificaciones, yo creo que sí vale la pena intentarlo.
Gracias. José is asking is it possible for him to apply if he has a TOEFL IBT with 88 score?
And I think it will be, I think the minimum is 90, right, Mayela?
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, unfortunately, I'm sorry that you're so close to the limit there, but that is where our admissions office, they will have this cut for 90.
Right. Francisco also is asking regarding the English language requirement. He says that the university can certify B1, English B1, Is it enough or is it necessary to take the international exam, or is there any other way to certify different from the TOEFL?
I'm sure about the B2 in English, then it's no problem if they could do, but B1, I'm not sure about that, so I would strongly recommend to do the English proficiency as well. Mayela, maybe you know here as well a little bit.
Yo hice el TOEFL, igual mi escuela me certificaba, no sé, me acuerdo qué nivel, pero bastante alto, pero a mí se me dijeron que a fuerza tenía que ser el internacional. Y digo, sí entiendo por qué, porque pues al final todos los cursos son en inglés. Y algo muy característico del KTH es que todos tienen un enfoque muy hacia research, leer muchísimos ya artículos científicos. Entonces, a veces hasta había sentido que me falta un poquito del inglés porque hay mucha terminología, hay mucha cosa que sí, el inglés sí lo tienes que tener bien, ahora sí que bien sólido, porque pues toda la comunicación, todo lo que escribes, todo es en inglés. Entonces, yo creo que sí vale la pena venir con un inglés pues bastante avanzado, y pues solamente se puede demostrar eso a través de los exámenes internacionales.
And I think if you fulfill the requirements, in my experience, there was usually everyone, even though you feel like, oh, when I arrived to Sweden, my English was not so strong, after a couple of months or the first semester, you will improve a lot, so you don't have to be worried. But the requirements are pretty tough, as Mayela also said, that there is probably a good reason for that. But I don't think you should be worried when you arrive to KTH as well, when you have been accepted.
Okay, thank you. Well, there are some people asking about the PhD scholarships. So I think Mayela just answered the question by explaining that the PhD is like a job where you are hired to research. We're going to send the recording of this session. So if you would like to hear again the answers or hear again the presentation, you will have the YouTube link in a couple of days. And there are also some people asking about specific fields such as data science, business administration, biotech, and production engineering. So could you share please with us where they can check the academic offer?
Yes. So at the webpage, we try to do a lot of to summarize the information about the programs. So each master program have a webpage where you have contact persons who are responsible for the program. Also a little bit about the curriculum, and also quite a lot about the objective of the program and what the focus is of the program, and also the career where students have gone after they studied the program. So I think if you go to kth.se, the webpage, and you go to studies and choose master studies, then you will find all the programs, and you can click on the programs and find. And if you have more questions, you are very welcome to contact the persons that are provided in the webpage for each program. You can write them freely, and they are there to inform you about the program. And general questions, I mean, about KTH, and also like general questions about the program, you can also, I can write the email here, I should write it, info@kth.se. But this is more for general questions. And then in the program sites, you will have the actual professors or the administrators working with that particular program.
Okay, thank you. And Jesus is asking about the duration of the programs. Are all of the masters 2 years long, or do you have shorter?
Yeah, we masters? Almost all of the programs are 2 years in duration, but we have a few. I think it's like 2 programs that are 1 year programs. Quite a popular program is the 1 year program in innovation. It's a 1 year program in entrepreneurship and innovation given by our industrial engineering department. That this is not so focused on engineering as such, but a lot more on project management and innovation processes.
Thank you. Well, we receive a very specific question from Eduardo. He says, I am a geoscientist, and I have been working in research about processing seismic signals. Do you think that mathematics or machine learning programs can be flexible enough to keep this line of study?
His background is in with machine learning or?
Geoscientist, like.
Yeah, okay, it's like geology or?
Yes, like I think okay. Geology. He has been researching about seismic signals, like
yeah.
The earth movement.
Yes, actually we have some what is it called? Geopositioning and this kind of thing and measuring of the topography of land. But I would also recommend, we have another university in Sweden where it's very strong in seismology, that is called Uppsala, one of the oldest universities in Sweden, Uppsala University, that has a very famous department in geology and especially with professors in seismology. But at KTH, we do a lot of this, of course, since we have the whole construction, the civil engineering faculties and subjects, we do this geopositioning and sensoring. So that is a part that is related, perhaps, to what he's doing. Geophysics. Okay, yeah, sure. So actually, a good thing you can do is on the webpage is to search in the search field for geophysics, and you can see a little bit about what kind of articles or departments that have publicized, and maybe that could be related to what you are doing or are interested in as well.
Okay. Thank you so much. And this question is for Mayela. Mencionaste que no obtuviste la beca con KTH. ¿Cómo financias tus estudios y aproximadamente cuál es el costo de vida mensual?
¿Cómo financié mis estudios? Pues con todos mis ahorros, la verdad. Yo trabajé casi 3 años desde que me gradué, entonces tenía pues ahora sí que mi guardadito y me gasté todo ese, mi familia me apoyó un poco. Y en México teníamos la oportunidad de sacar un crédito, o sea que en resumidas cuentas me endeudé. Pero pues al final eso explica lo mucho que me gusta estar acá y que vale la pena y que pues venga el endeudamiento con tal de estar acá. Entonces... busqué un crédito que fuera con una tasa baja, entonces yo lo que hice fue, yo lo veo no como un gasto, sino como una inversión en mí y en mi futuro, porque yo sí me quiero quedar acá, y creo que si uno logra conseguir una chamba acá, con los salarios que ganan acá, pagas cualquier crédito sin ningún problema. Entonces yo me fui con esa idea, con la esperanza de conseguir un trabajo de tiempo completo cuando me gradúe, y ya con eso poder pagar mi crédito. Pero realmente lo hice a través de crédito porque en México no había tanta oportunidad de becas. El KTH está sumamente competida. Entonces, pues hubo que endeudarse. Y de lo de los gastos, como estudiantes internacionales tenemos que tramitar un permiso de residencia por estudios. Y Migración te pide, si no mal recuerdo, alrededor de 9,000 coronas al mes. Entonces tú tienes que demostrar ante Migración que tienes esa cantidad para los 12 meses o 24 meses que vayas a estar acá. El permiso se puede tramitar cada año, o creo que tienen una prueba piloto de hacerlo los 2 años de un jalón, pero tienes que mostrar que tienes esa cantidad, pero no significa que necesites esa cantidad. Yo la verdad vivo con menos que eso, mi renta son aproximadamente 4,500 coronas, son 450 euros, no tengo la conversión a dólares. Y pues depende mucho ahora sí que pues de los gustos personales, yo casi no consumo carne, la carne tiende a ser más costosa, pero pues yo me iría por unos 700, 800 euros al mes viviendo como estudiante. Si uno quiere darse una vida más de lujos, pues igual si te sale más caro, pero pues en lo que más se gasta uno a lo mejor es en salir a restaurantes, pues todas las bebidas alcohólicas es lo que tiende a ser sumamente costoso acá, pero también hay mucho acceso a áreas verdes, puedes hacer picnics, compras tu súper y te preparas algo y te lo vas a comer con tus amigos, vas a casa de amigos y realmente no tiene que ser tan costoso. Entonces, Migración sugiere, creo que son 9,800, 9,000 y cachito coronas al mes, pero pues yo le echo unas 7, 8, más o menos, 1,000 coronas.
Thank you. Well, and lastly, I would like to ask you which recommendation or advice could you give to the people that are starting the process, starting to check the degrees, and they are going to apply to KTH? For both of you is the question.
I would just emphasize maybe once again that also that don't be too worried about the GPA. I think Mayela said also that it's a dynamic score. It's not that we have a fixed every year that this is the minimum. It depends on how many people who are applying and the score that the whole group, the median score of the whole group, that will be some kind of decisive. So you never know. Maybe in the subject that you are applying, there are not so many students applying this year with a high GPA. Which I also think is really good that KTH does is that we don't only look in the scores, we also on the grades, we look also in the motivation, the explanation why you would like to study at KTH and why you want to study this subject and how to use it in the future, for example, for innovation or sustainability projects. So that is probably, and then also, of course, try to apply for several scholarships. KTH, the Swedish Institute, Call for Toro, if you're a PhD in Colombia, maybe Min Ciencias have funding and so on.
Yes.
Pues yo les sugeriría hacer las cosas con tiempo. A mí no me gusta estar a las prisas y tratar de conseguir todos los papeles de último momento. Entonces, siempre es mejor con tiempo, aunque está este colchón de tiempo en el que si te faltó mandar algo, te dan la oportunidad de mandarlo en este periodo. Pero igual luego uno subestima los tiempos de espera, a lo mejor de ciertos resultados, o que es el papel, o que si ya no escribí la carta, si estaba la firma, etcétera, etcétera. Entonces yo lo que recomiendo para la aplicación de esto, para el permiso, para absolutamente todo lo que vayan a hacer, hacerlo con suficiente tiempo de anticipación, tomarse el tiempo de meterse a la página y ahí mandé el link. Esa es la lista de todos los programas de maestría que ofrece KTH o en general la mayoría. Y ahí se puede ver incluso lo que contiene cada curso que deberías de tomar. Entonces darse la tarea de entrar y ver si realmente es lo que les llama la atención y lo que quieren hacer. Y pues yo creo que sería bueno, y obviamente que apliquen, entonces si ya van a aplicar, pues apliquen a, creo que se puede máximo 4 programas por aplicación, no me acuerdo si 4 o 3, entonces tratar de aplicar a, pues ahora sí que a los más que se pueda, a los más que les interesen. Algo importante es que en University Admissions, que es en donde se aplica, te piden que ranquees tus opciones, entonces le van a dar prioridad a la que ranquees como tu número 1, 2, 3 y 4. Entonces, si no se tomen a la ligera el ranking, porque si entran en la primera, ni siquiera te van a checar la segunda. Entras a la primerita que aplicaste, entonces realmente sí tómense el tiempo de decidir cuál es la que más quieren para que la pongan en primer lugar y así se vayan yendo. Y pues nada, no tengan miedo. Es un proceso que sí realmente es abrumador, uno siente que son muchas cosas, pero es algo que es poco a poco, consigan todo, lo mandan y pues ya, la verdad es que no es nada muy, muy complicado.
Thank you. It's really good, Mayela, that you mentioned. I forgot that that you can apply to 4 programs and each application. So you can select 4 programs at the same time. And as Mayela was saying, you have to prioritize it. But in the same time, if you're not accepted to the first, you will be evaluated for the second program or the third. Or the fourth.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for this presentation, for the information, Mayela and Magnus. It was a pleasure to have you here. A las personas que se conectaron también, muchas gracias por sus preguntas, por haber estado muy atentos en esta sesión. Si alguno tiene preguntas acerca del programa Crédito Beca de Colfuturo, tenemos 2 sesiones informativas al mes, el primer viernes de cada mes a las 8 de la mañana y el segundo sábado de cada mes a las 9:30 por nuestra página web colfuturo.org. Van a poder conectarse, también nos pueden enviar las preguntas al correo yosoyfuturo@colfuturo.org, que lo estoy escribiendo en el chat. y los invitamos a seguirnos en redes sociales, Instagram principalmente, para poder estar atentos a nuestra programación. Vamos a estar teniendo durante septiembre, octubre, noviembre, más universidades invitadas. So that was it. Thank you so much for this presentation again.
Well, thank you. Thank you, and to all of you for taking your time to listen to us. And we are very attentive here to welcome you to KTH if you decide to apply.
Feliz día.